And this is Mission Control Houston, so Expedition 40 crew currently on board. Station crews typically training for an average of about 2 years ahead of their six-month voyages on orbit. NASA always looking to better prepare the astronauts for their time in space and also better prepare the agency itself for future missions, not only to the station, but as we look to go even further into deep space. One training method known as an analog, where we're able to simulate some of the environments that astronauts will see in these isolated deep space situations, is called NEMO, or the NASA Extreme Environment Mission Operations, where astronauts from around the globe will go down to Aquarius, which is 60 feet underwater off the Florida coast. One mission, NEMO mission, just wrapped up in July. Another one scheduled to begin coming up soon in September. This one will be commanded by NASA veteran astronaut Randy Bresnik. Randy joining me here now inside of Mission Control. Randy, thanks so much for joining me. Really appreciate it. Good to see you here this morning. So first off, start us off. So this is going to be NEMO 19. Give us a little bit of background real quick on your mission that's coming up.
Yeah, NEMO 19, we actually splashed down on the 8th of September for a seven-day mission. And we're going to build on what was done earlier this summer with NEMO, mm-hmm. NEMO 18. The NEMO team is, you know, works really well every year diligently to try and get analogs and fill in the gaps between what we know now and what we maybe might want to do with exploration missions in the future. And so it's really good because we can simulate zero gravity. We can simulate, you know, partial gravity like mm-hmm. the moon. We can simulate Mars gravity, you know, maybe asteroid microgravity with the way outs in the suits. So we can actually check the equipment out. We can check the processes out. We can check out working with Mission Control. And one of the highlights of this particular one is we'll be on a time delay, simulating that we have a communications issue because we're a long ways away from home. So how do we work operationally through our spacewalks when we do have to deal with, we send a transmission, we don't hear anything back for 10 minutes.
So there's going to be that long of a delay. So what kind of a mission is that kind of simulating? Is that like you guys are on Mars? Is that you guys are at an asteroid? What is that? What is that?
That's
kind of taking place?
Somewhere in between Mars and here. I think if I'm correct, I think Mars is a 20-minute with current technology.
Wow.
Now, maybe with NASA and some of the stuff we're working, we're able to come up with a better communications technology that cuts down that mm-hmm. delay.
Okay. So. And very much like the International Space Station, it's an international crew that's going to be down there at Aquarius. Tell us a little bit about the guys and girls that are going to be going down with you.
We've got a really great crew. We've got Andy Mogensen, who's the very first Danish astronaut.
Okay.
And he's actually participated in some of the NEMO-like training last year, so he's kind of a veteran in that regard. But he's the super smart guy. He's the PhD type who used to guidance navigation design.
He's the brains of the group.
Yes, he's the brains of the outfit. But he's actually flying next September with on a Soyuz crew with Sarah Brightman.
Mm-hmm.
And so he'll at least have some decent music on his flight. super smart guy. Really, really good operator, and so we're lucky to have him. We also have Hervé Stevenin, who is the lead for what is ESA's European Astronaut Training Center underwater training facility. So they're mm-hmm. basically their MBL. He's one of our crew members. And the neat part about that is that he's also one of the Eurocoms. So he'll sit, you know, in the Capcom slot over there in Europe,
mm-hmm.
and you know what we're able to help him do is now this is his first chance to act as an operator. And so, ideally, by learning to be a better operator, he can then be a better capsule communicator and help
directly
the flight control team.
Yep.
Exactly. And then we have Canadian astronaut Jeremy Hansen, also known as Weed. Another great operator, really smart on the robotics side mm-hmm. of things, with being a Canadian and the robotic arm. But also an even funnier guy than Chris Hadfield. So we're really lucky to have him along for comedic relief.
It'll be good when you're, you know, 60 feet under the water, get lighten the spirits a little bit. So and robotics are going to play a big role in this, and some telepresence and that mm-hmm. kind of thing. So can you tell me a little bit about
that? Yeah, it's really some really, really neat objectives. There's program that's called Heads Up, which the ESA is sponsoring, and mm-hmm. Hervé, our crew member, is actually one of the program leads. And it allows basically mobile procedure viewing. So all the times, you know, when you look here on the screen behind us and you see the crew doing work on station, you'll see them hands in and working, and they have their headlamp on. You always see them pop back out, and you'll see them look up on a tablet or look up on a computer screen, or have to reach their hand out and type to move the screen.
What am I doing right now?
Yeah, exactly. And so what this ideally is with a heads-up device that we'll be wearing, we'll be able to not have to take our eyes or hands off the project, and we'll be able to get, you know, either the procedures, you know, viewed on a heads-up display. We'll also be able to maybe have work on more of the telepresence type of operations, where the ground through a camera on our heads-up display will be able to see what we're doing, and then offer suggestions, you know, kind of helping us look over the shoulder, all in an effort to be more efficient, you know, in the work we do, and more precise.
All right. And you, NEMA is not the only analog that you've been involved in. Another one was CAVES. And forgive me, I don't remember what the acronym stands for. There are way too many at NASA. Tell me a little about CAVES. First, what does it stand for?
CAVES, it was a cooperative behavior health type thing. I'm sorry, I don't remember the acronym exactly myself. Our friends at ESA came up with that one. So NASA cannot claim responsibility for that. But it was actually in the CAVE complexes in Sardinia in Italy. And I was part of the fortunate enough to be part of the first expedition in 2011 where we went over there. And it really was a phenomenal analog. It, you know, we try and get the environments such that people can train there and get some sort of the sensations and feelings and operational, you know, concerns that we'd have up in space, so that once they get to space, it's that much easier because they've sort of been there a little bit before. So previously, we'd always been in partnership with the National Orbital Leadership School, NOLS. This CAVES was the ESA addition to the suite of analogs. Obviously, NEMO's been a very important one for you know, almost 20 years now here at NASA. And CAVES was great because you're underground, number one. You don't have the sun, so you have no idea what time it is, just like on the space station where you have 16 sunrises and sunsets every day. The temperature and humidity are exactly the same all the time.
Just like on the space station.
You're sitting there, you've got tethers and climbing equipment because there's chasms and places, you know, there's the constant fear of death. And you have to all the constant be, you know, worried about your tether protocols and things like that, just like you do on a spacewalk. You have to take care of your own bodily functions and bring that out with you and take care of it just like we do up on space station.
So a lot of parallels.
A lot of parallels. And it was just really, the most amazing part was the fact that it's an environment you've never been in before. And as you can see from the pictures that they displayed, absolutely gorgeous and just amazing. And we were actually mapping out parts of the CAVE complex that have never been mapped before. And so there was that excitement of, okay, we're going to go through this little squeeze area, and we have no idea what's on the other side. It could end up being nothing, or it could end up being a cavern and an amazing, you know, basketball stadium-sized room underground that you're now mapping out and trying to find out where to continue on the rest of your exploration. And so there was really a good sense of that feeling that we'd have if we were on another terrestrial body where it's different,
where
it's new, and no one's ever been there.
Yeah. All right. Well, and then so back to NEMO real quick. A big piece of it is going to be spacewalking. Now, we train for spacewalks here underwater at the NBL. And you guys are going to be doing some spacewalks when you're out there, you know, down in Florida. What are you guys going to be doing out in the water? I know you that's probably one of the more exciting things. So
fills the majority of our days while we're down there. We have some really neat technology demonstrators that will help us fill in the gap because we know that robotics is really good. And we've had some phenomenal robotic work. You know, just look at the Mars robotic effort we've had so far. And we also know that people can do good work. But we also know that the robotic stuff that's on Mars, although they have phenomenal work, we also know that in the year or two that, you know, say one of those rovers has been out there, that's the work that a human could do in a day or two.
Yeah.
And so what can we do to use our robotics to go out as precursors? So imagine we land humans on Mars. And we've got 5-10 robots we can send out to areas of interest that all our researchers want us to go look at. They take a look and then send back the information, and the the astronauts or the mission control, they look at that data and go, well, these two don't really look that promising. These two do, so we'll go ahead and, you know, go look over there. Well, we've got a system now for NEMO 19 called the Diver Delivery System. Shark Marine makes that. And it is actually going to allow us to go out and try to fill that gap and see if we can really use these robotics as we'd like. And so we'll send them out on a mission. They can be sent out autonomously. They can carry an astronaut with them if we want to use them as transport. They have a navigation system. They have cameras on board, and they can hover in one spot. And we'll use those in combination with actually an autonomous ROV, autonomous robot with cameras, that the IV, or the internal vehicle astronaut or Aquanaut will be able to fly as a robotic camera, and use those as a way to see if we can use these robotic type things to act and get us into the right spots. Obviously, we'll be compounded by the fact we have that comm delay. So we'll have to have a really good idea what the intent is for mission control so that we don't end up sitting around waiting for a transmission to come back and we find something we don't expect or find something we don't like, or we'll be able to go, okay, we know our priorities, move to the next site, send one of our robots over there to take a look and get it ready for us.
It's really a great way to prepare us for the missions of tomorrow by doing stuff right here in our own backyard. It's really fascinating stuff. Or right under our backyard. All right, again, NASA astronaut Randy Breznik is going to be the commander of NEMO 19 joining me here in Mission Control today. Randy, thanks so much. Fascinating stuff. Good luck on the mission. Watch out for hurricanes.
Thank you very much.